Hi, I'm Jasmine. Our very own Captain Ashok Mahapatra has been promoted to Director, Maritime Safety Divisions at the IMO. Our editor, Captain Sunil Nangya, spoke to him on different subjects. Let's have a look.
Congratulations on achieving a most commendable career milestone.
Thank you very much.
So on this occasion, may I please request you to share your valuable thoughts and vision with us?
Yeah, the thoughts and this thing is, I'm very glad that I've been able to get this position.
As Director Maritime Safety Division at the International Maritime Organization, what would be your primary role, sir?
The first primary role of the Director of the Maritime Safety Division is that he is the Secretary to the Maritime Safety Committee. Now, the Maritime Safety Committee is responsible for safety and security for the shipping in general. To this end, there are a few conventions which are under the purview of this committee. The first being the SOLAS, which is the safety of life at sea. The next one is the standards of training, certification and watchkeeping. In addition, there is the FAL convention, the other various codes which come along with, which are associated with both the STCW and the SOLAS convention. So primarily what I oversee is being the Secretary to the Maritime Safety Committee, which looks at all aspects of safety of life at sea and property, as well as the security of ship to ensure its efficiency.
Sir, please share about your journey with IMO so far. When did you join and how did it affect your career as well as your personal life? Being a master mariner, how was the job profile and responsibility different from your work on ships?
Yeah, this is a very interesting subject. I came here in 1998 as a technical officer, primarily engaged to do the oversight of the STCW convention. In the STCW convention, for the first time, the International Maritime Organization took on the responsibility for the oversight to ensure that member governments were implementing the convention both in spirit as well as in totality. To this end, there was this structure which came into the big play, and member governments had to give documentary evidence that they were going to implement the convention. Now this became quite interesting because I came in from the Director General of Shipping, where I used to oversee the examination of masters and mates, and I had just been the Deputy Nautical Advisor there. So, came in here, and within a couple of months of my joining, the communication of information in accordance with Regulation 1.7 started flowing in, and then by the deadline of 1st August 1998, if I'm not mistaken and my memory serves me correct, we had 86 countries which had submitted their information. This information had to be scrutinized by panels of competent persons, and then a report made to the Maritime Safety Committee by the Secretary General. So we had to set up panels for every country, and that itself was a challenge because documentation would be submitted in any of the three working languages of the organization, that is in English, French and Spanish. So we had to have the panels set up in such a way that they could scrutinize the documentation in the languages submitted. At the same time, one had to also keep in mind the political sensitivities and ensure that the panels did not have people who were not acceptable to governments. So that went on, and in the process, 86 panels to coordinate them and start getting the work done was itself a challenge, and bringing it to fruition, and then finally report to the Maritime Safety Committee, which would then came up with what is today popularly known as the White List. So that is where I started my journey. Then subsequently, I took over as the head of the section, or basically of the SCCW. And consequently, during that process, I also oversaw the revision of the convention once again, which culminated in the 2010 Manila Amendments. And after that, there was a new challenge when I took over as the senior editor director for the subdivision on operational safety and human element. That means it expanded my portfolio not only from the training aspects but also the operational aspects, which saw me overseeing the subcommittees on navigation, communication, search and rescue, and the SCCW subcommittee, which was the standard of training and watchkeeping. And then today, yesterday, in fact, I took over as the director of the Maritime Safety Division, which now I encompass the whole lot of the division.
Safe, secure, and efficient shipping on clean oceans is the slogan that effectively sums up the objectives of IMO. With 170 members, how challenging is the task of getting member states to implement the standards, rules and regulations set by IMO?
First thing, what the IMO does is actually brings in the international regulations to ensure that shipping moves seamlessly from one part to another, so that we don't get stuck with regionalism. By and large, in the IMO, we work through a consensus. It is challenging. 170 countries, everybody has their own interests to safeguard. But so far, the organization has fantastic spirit of cooperation. Having said that, once that has been negotiated and the conventions are put in place, or the amendments are put in place, it is then up to the member states to transform these regulations into national legislation. That is quite challenging for a lot of national legislation, because in some cases the priorities, the parliamentary time priorities, take over. IMO as such is not a policeman. That is a privilege and responsibility of the member states themselves. But we do have this challenge of trying to work out the implementation. And to that end, today we have got what is called member state audit, which would look at how countries are implementing the regulations and this. The idea is not to criticize people, but to assist member states to see if they are falling short in their capacity or their this way that they are going to do certain things, but for some reason they are not able to do so. Then we identify them, and once that is identified by the organization, then it gains a little more urgency within the government itself. So the people who are dealing with the shipping are able to go to their political masters for better resources, etc., to implement the convention. But so far, I must say that we have a fairly good record of implementation. Primarily because ships move all over the place, and that is why they go from one country to another. So even if the governments don't want it, the ship owners do put in a fair amount of pressure to ensure that the regulations are being implemented.
Sir, how is shipping today different from when you joined?
Oh, it's quite different, honestly, because let's put it this way. When I joined in 73, we had primarily general cargo ships. Containerization was coming in very slowly. We used to have containers on deck, and as a result, we used to get fair amount of port stay, and we had a fairly larger number of crew. But today the thing has changed, and of course the maxim that ships earn money when they are at sea and they lose money when they are in port still holds good. So the turnaround times have become less. But on the other hand, if you look at it, the first time I went on ship, I did non-stop 39 months, and today you will find people are talking of 2 months on, 2 months off. So things have changed. But
So what would be your message and advice to the youngsters who would want to take up this career now?
Very good thing that you asked me this, because let me give you a little bit of background on this as to how I came out to sea and how I would go about it if I had to relive my life. I was in college and I appeared for the medical entrance examination.
Oh, I see.
I cleared the medical entrance examination. I was fourth on that on the merit list. When I went up to take admission in the medical college, I was told I could not join. So I was a little surprised. I said, why? They said, I should have attained 17 years on the 31st of October.
Oh.
But my date of birth was 7th November. So I was short of age by 7 days. So they told me I can't. So I was quite frustrated in the sense, and I went and I said, then you should not have allowed me to appear for the examination. And those were the days before we had this judicial activism where you could go to court and challenge these people. So honestly, during that time, I was very frustrated. So somewhere I met people joining the ship and all that. And so I put a couple of handwritten applications to companies. And then I got a call from Sindhias. I went and appeared for the interview. Didn't know anybody there. They offered me an apprenticeship. And there I was. And I joined as a cadet in 1973. And since then, I have not looked back. And if I now do a introspection, what would have happened if I had become a doctor? At best, I would have been sitting in some medical college trying to do certain things. But would it have given me the international recognition that I have today?
Shipping has given you, yeah.
It has given me. The other thing that I will tell the youngsters today is that which other job at the age of 21, 22, 23, when you are standing between watch all by yourself on the bridge, having come the total control of asset with cargo and the ship, running close to $1 billion, that kind of responsibility, where else do you get it? I am yet to come across in my life anybody at that young age having that kind of responsibility and the challenge. So, and if I have to go back and start at 70 again, I always say that I will relive this life and continue to come back to sea.
Great. So, lucky for shipping industry that you didn't get into medicals, and lucky for DG Shipping, and lucky for IMO now. Coming back to our questions, as a maritime nation, as far as India is concerned, what changes do you suggest? What changes should India make to work towards regaining its past glory and position as a global leader in shipping business?
See, that will depend a lot on how the political class look at it. One thing that they need to recognize that for India to become a great global power, they need their economy to grow and stand. How does the economy grow? The economy cannot grow without shipping. No economy can grow without shipping. Shipping, the world economy moves or grows only because of shipping. If you pull shipping out of it, then there is no movement of goods either way, whether it is a processed good or raw material. So what they need to do is, once they get their ideas about the growth targets and all that, they need to look at what are the factors involved in maintaining this. And one of the major factors is shipping. Once they have recognized that, then they can start making the processes simpler. And I'm not saying that there should not be any processes. I'm a great one to say that processes and regulations are required, because otherwise there will be chaos. Because unless there are rules, regulations and laws, you cannot have a systematic and sustained process of trade and growth. So that is what they need to do, is recognize that shipping is an integral part to the growth and of the economy, as well as to bring it, India, to a stage where the world looks up at you as someone to be proud of. And in this, they need their own ships. They make it more simpler. We are a manpower supplying nation. We need to keep that. But at the same time, we have challenges because there are other professions that are coming to challenge the entry levels to shipping.
Yes.
So these are the challenges that both the industry and the government need to look at.
Well, congratulations. Enjoy your new job. Enjoy your new cabin. And we will be in touch. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Sunil. All the best.
Thank you for talking to Sailor Today TV. Bye-bye.